president elect Biden appears set to block it again. Marketplace's Nova Sacco joins me now with more. Nova, what are the details of what Biden intends to do?
Well, Biden appears ready to
that bill was passed days later, and it was on President Johnson's desk. More than 50 years on, fair housing advocates say the law has been weakened. Last year, the Trump administration repealed an Obama-era rule called Affirmatively Furthering Fair Housing as part of its push for deregulation. The rule had required local governments to develop plans to address housing segregation. Attention, like addressing the pandemic that has especially hurt people of color, she says, in part because of segregation. I'm Amy Scott for Marketplace.
And I'm Sabri Benishour with the Marketplace Morning Report. From APM, American Public Media.
WLRN's New Year's resolution is our renewed commitment to provide you with all the news and information you need in the year ahead. Why not kick off your new year on the right foot by becoming a financial supporter of WLRN for the first time? When you take that step from being a listener to a listener contributor, it feels really good. You'll see for yourself when you make this your moment to donate an amount that's right for you. Or give for someone who can't at WLRN.org. And Happy New Year.
If you're ready for a staycation, you can come to Florida's Hollywood, a short drive from anywhere in South Florida, featuring a mix of resorts, boutique hotels, and the oceanfront boardwalk. It can be the perfect local setting for a change of scenery and a splash of fun. Learn more at floridashollywood.org.
This is 91.3 WLRN HD1, Miami Fort Lauderdale, 91.5 WKWM and HD1 Marathon in Key West, 90.7 WFLB HD4 in West Palm Beach, and 101.9 NPR. Palm Beach is all the way from Key West to Jupiter. It's WLRN.
How will it end? Ain't got a friend. My only sin is in my skin. What did I do to be so black and
at 88.9 FM, you're tuned to WDNA Miami. Public radio, redefined.
Head of the World Health Organization has said the world is on the point of a catastrophic moral failure from the way COVID-19 vaccines are being shared out. Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus said it was wrong that some countries and companies continue to prioritize bilateral deals. Naomi Grimley reports.
This is the starkest warning yet from Dr. Tedros. The wealthy countries are pursuing what he calls a me-first approach, even though they may claim they want to see vaccines distributed fairly. He said 39 million doses had now been administered in 49 higher income countries, but compared that with only 25 doses in one of the world's poorest states. He argued it could not be right that younger, healthy people in richer countries would be vaccinated before healthcare workers and the elderly in the developing world.
The judge in Moscow has ruled that the Russian opposition activist Alexei Navalny must stay in custody for at least 30 days. Another hearing next week will determine whether he's to complete a 3.5-year prison sentence for alleged embezzlement, stemming from a case criticised by the European Court of Human Rights. Reports from Darfur in Sudan say clashes that broke out in the rest of the region last Saturday have now spread to the south. Here's David Bradford.
The French news agency quotes tribal leaders as saying at least 20 people died in an attack by Arab militiamen on Sardoun in South Darfur, inhabited by the non-Arab Falata community. They're said to have used trucks, motorbikes and camels in a surprise raid. The report comes only a day after more than 80 people were confirmed dead in clashes near El Geneina in West Darfur. Nearly 3 weeks ago, the United Nations and the African Union ended their long-running joint peacekeeping mission in the region.
Reports from Yemen say dozens of pro-government troops and Houthi rebel fighters have been killed in fierce clashes over the weekend. The fighting has raged on the edge of the Red Sea port of Hodeidah, which is in rebel hands. A truce is supposed to be in force in Hodeidah. Alan Johnston has more details.
Hodeidah is a really significant location. It's a major port on the Red Sea coast. Huge amounts of food and other imports flow into Yemen via Hodeidah's docks, and it is extremely important that that food continues flowing in because the situation is extraordinarily serious. Just a few days ago, the UN said that 50,000 people were starving in famine conditions after years of war, and there's every danger that the situation will get even worse.
Alan Johnston reporting. You're listening to the latest world news from the BBC. The Italian Prime Minister Giuseppe Conte has urged Parliament not to sack his government at a time of national crisis, as he battles to overcome the desertion of a junior coalition partner. Opposing a no-confidence motion, Mr. Conte told the lower house that the coronavirus was still in full force. He said his government had taken resolute action, even at the most difficult of times. Israel has revealed that it's sharing huge amounts of data with the COVID vaccine-making firm Pfizer. From Jerusalem, here's Tom Bateman.
Israel is still racing ahead in vaccine delivery. More than 2 million people have had at least one jab, accounting for around a quarter of the population. It's released a section of its contract with Pfizer. Parts of the text are blacked out, but it shows how Israel has effectively become a real-time results dashboard for the drug maker. The contract says its goal is to see what proportion of Israel's population needs to be vaccinated to achieve so-called herd immunity.
Malawi is rolling out its first significant restrictions to control the coronavirus after President Lazarus Chakwera overruled a high court ban on the lockdown measures to tackle the surge in cases. Judges had ruled in April that insufficient measures were in place to cushion the loss of people's livelihoods, but the president said he had to act now for the common good. A nighttime curfew has been introduced, schools have been shut for 3 weeks, gatherings limited, and face masks are now mandatory in public. The opposition leader in Peru, Keiko Fujimori, says that if she wins the coming presidential election, she will pardon her jailed father, Alberto Fujimori. Ms. Fujimori, who leads the right-wing Popular Force Party, said she had changed her stance on the matter. Alberto Fujimori is serving a 25-year jail sentence for human rights abuses committed when he was president of Peru more than 2 decades ago. That's the latest. BBC News.
WDNA.